Welcome to San Diego Integral, October 14th, 2023. Today's topic is Gender Fluidity Evolution's Move to Non-Duality, presented by Shara Moscinska and her kids.
So, welcome to San Diego Integral. I'm Tom Habib, and I'm a member of the Integral Leadership Team. We have an exciting presentation today. The name of it is Gender Fluidity Evolution's Move to Non-Duality. We'll begin shortly, but I first wanted to mention that we will be recording this meeting. So if you prefer not to be seen on video, if somebody's looking for you and you don't want to be discovered, you can just turn off your camera. Although we like to see your faces, it helps the interaction. A link to recording will be posted on Meetup in a day or two after the event and on San Diego Integral's YouTube. Did you know we have a YouTube? Also, you can find future events on our website at sandiegointegral.org. We're also on Meetup and Facebook, and you can find links to those as well on the website. One of the advantages of joining one of these groups is you'll be automatically notified when a new event is added. If you ever have any questions, comments, or critiques, deliver them to Eloy. No, I'm only kidding. And you're welcome to contact one of the leadership team on either Facebook or Meetup. Next month, we're meeting on November 11th, but the topic is to be announced. So please watch for the date and sign up. Finally, we invite you to make a small donation today to help cover the cost of hosting and fees and future development. You can make that donation at sandiegointegral.org. Okay, so without further ado, Eloy is going to introduce our distinguished speaker tonight.
Yeah, so I'm pleased to be introduced to Shara through Kathy Andrews, who's in our leadership team. She made the connection with Shara for us, and she's been attending meetings with us and dropping gems of wisdom. And it's really cool to see how deeply ingrained and integral she is. She's kind of a revolutionary in that serves as a minister and chief evolutionary officer at Unity of Tustin. And her team's implementing a 3 to 5 year integral ministry program in collaboration with Drs. Gary and Jane Simmons. She's part of the Integral Christian Network, and she brought this intriguing topic recently, and I had never thought of it in the terms of where it could take us. Like it was just seemed like a cultural phenomenon to me, but I'm looking forward to hearing. And so along with Shara, she brought her daughter Grace and Ivan, and I want to acknowledge the I don't want to say courage, but the wisdom to bring this to us, to all of us. So with that, I give it to Shara, Grace, and Ivan.
Thank you, Eloy. Thank you, San Diego Integral. Thank you, everyone. It's really lovely just to be here with you all. And, I'm a psychotherapist, recently turned Unity minister. I serve as the Minister Chief Evolutionary Officer at Unity of Tustin. And as Eloy said, we're in this really aspiration to become a second tier organization, to move into a infrastructure that really moves from minister centricity to evolutionary purpose centricity, where we create infrastructure for ownership participant leadership, where we do a lot of shadow work so we can be a clear field from what something new can emerge. We know the church of tomorrow will not look like the church of today. So we are aspiring to be a fertile ground for evolution. And in that journey, I find myself in many integral and spiritually progressive spaces. And yet I don't hear much conversation about this cultural emergence of gender expansiveness. Even though for me, I think what's most interesting is what is on the cutting edge of cultural emergence. And as we know, evolution is moving forward and faster. I think in our lifetimes, it's our youth that's going to be showing us what's next. So in that spirit, I invited my two intrepid and creative, beautiful children to join me. And I'd love it if, Ivan, you introduce yourself and tell a little bit about your journey and perspective on gender expansiveness. And then, Grace, if you continue, and then we'll take it from there.
Hi, my name is Ivan, and I am my pronouns are he, him. I'm 16 years old, and I'm a sophomore in high school. I like music and snowboarding, hiking, and my friends. And I'm a trans male, and I think my trans journey began like when I was 7, I'd say. I mean, there's build up before that, but my mom told me that she let me shop in the boys section of the store for the first time, and I like lit up and I started throwing clothes in the shopping cart. And I don't know, I still used she, her pronouns. And I've never really heard of a trans person, or that wasn't really talked about, so I didn't know that like existed. But around like 7th grade, I started more people talked about it, and it got more talked about. So I was experimenting with my pronouns and what pronouns I was most comfortable with. And by the time I was in 8th grade, I had my pronouns were he, him. And I started wanting to move forward with that and transition socially. And I got a therapist, and I started talking to my doctor about it and transitioning medically. And then I came out to my parents, and that was a journey in and of itself, but it's gotten good. And then I got an appointment with a transgender specialist, and we had meetings, and I started hormones, testosterone, a little over 2 months ago. And I'm just very grateful for the supportive family and friends I had along the way. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Grace. My pronouns are he, they. So I'm currently a senior in high school, and it feels like I've gone a long way through my gender journey and sexuality journey. I feel like for me, those two went hand in hand. Like, as I was discovering my sexuality, I was also exploring my gender expression. And I think a lot of point, like, way, I think society has shaped me in a lot of ways. Like, I remember from elementary school, like, it was frowned upon to be a girly girl or to be anything feminine. Like, that was a negative trait to have. So I would always try to avoid those traits. Like, I was like, I would never like the color pink. And you get this from just the media you consume. I think my the media I've shown wasn't like all that out there. Like, it was pretty restricted, but it just shows how, like, even that little bit just shows like how women are supposed to be in society. So then moving on to middle school, I feel like people started getting treated very differently based off their gender. Like, I feel like I noticed it more, and I suddenly felt like I wasn't, like I was kind of small compared to some of the boys in my class who just kind of felt bigger than me. and not like in like a physical sense, but just like in the way they are treated. And then I remember I got a crush on a girl in around seventh grade. And before this, I kind of had crushes on guys. And I just thought that if a guy is nice to me and I'm nice to him, that means we're supposed to date. And then that kind of, I feel like, opened myself up to, like, really exploring, like, who do I like and how do I want to present myself? So now I would say I'm pretty comfortable in myself, still exploring the ideas of gender and how I fit in that and things like that. I would say I'm more comfortable in, so like, femininity, and I put air quotes just because I don't really personally like labeling things as feminine or masculine. But personally, I've been able to more accept that side that was like in elementary school, like disapproved as a kid. So that's where I am now. And I'm going to share a word chart with you all. Let me try doing that real quick. Let's see. Can everyone see that?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So this is a word chart of... Oh, wait. Wait. Okay, well, I'll ask this question after I'm done presenting. This is a word chart of, like, terms that are now used by the LGBTQ community, the queer community, any community. These are just new terms that will come up more in your daily life. And you might already use a lot of these terms or know about them, but they're not very obvious to everyone. So I was wondering if anyone had any questions or comments on these terms right here. Like, are you like, what does that mean? I actually like identify with that, and so on.
Could you tell us what MTF and FTM stands for?
Yeah, so this is an abbreviation to female and female to male. Oh. So if you're trans, you're going to say, like, just based off where you are, you're going to say, oh, I'm male to female, I'm female to male. And this is at least where I am, like, I see it used a lot, so I think it's helpful to know. So you're like, what does that abbreviation mean? But yeah.
Thank you.
Grace.
Yeah.
Can you say a few words about demi boy and demi girl?
Yeah, Ivan, can you elaborate on these?
Sure. Demi is like used as like half. So like demi boy and demi girl, they might identify as like half boy or like half girl. So you might see like their gender isn't specifically just a boy. It's half something else.
Thank you. Does that match with Two Spirit?
So Two Spirit is a term used in Native American communities. And yeah, so yeah, it's not the same.
So say more about Two-Spirit, if you would.
It's a term used in Native American communities. And I know that the Two-Spirit person often plays like a very important role in communities by teaching, like, I think the culture to the next generations. I'm not super informed on this one. But it's not a term that a white person could use. Let's just say that. So it's very specific to Native American communities.
Yeah, that Thank it's you. Important to realize that's, of course, an ancient term. It's not like all these new terms we now finally have in our culture. This existed, that a non-binary specification existed forever, as in many other cultures as well, by the way. We should not forget.
Yeah, that's a good point. Like, two-spirit people have existed since like forever. So it's not like a new term, it's not a new idea. So yeah, thanks for mentioning that.
What does genderqueer mean?
So genderqueer is kind of similar to like, kind of similar to like gender fluid and gender expansive. So genderqueer means just like, you don't really necessarily have a gender, you're just like, you're multiple genders, or you're questioning multiple genders.
Yes, that may answer my question. I'm wondering, I can't see all of these because my screen is fairly small, and I'm looking for terms that are basically non-binary without specifying how much male, female, or other. I'm remembering back when I was in grade school and junior high, I would go out and play with the boys more than with the girls, and I liked to go out and wrestle and do things, even though we had to wear skirts. But as I got on, you know, I'm definitely cisgender in my primary identification, that there's always been a fair amount of yang as well as yin, so to speak, in my body and my personality. And I'm finding that the non-binary is the closest I can find in your chart here. But I'm wondering if there are any terms that are smaller that would be just kind of that. Well, just going back to the earlier formulation where it's not assumed that sexuality is a binary or gender is absolutely binary. So I'm wondering if there are any of the smaller terms in here that would be that allow for that kind of blending.
Yeah, that's a really good question. I feel like I relate to you in like, I feel like I could be labeled as non-binary, but it's honestly not my favorite label to go by. So one of the ones, I'm a person who doesn't love labels in general, but I like the label agender because it means not gender. So it's kind of, even though it kind of goes, the definition goes against its name because you're saying agender, it's kind of used as like, you just don't connect with any gender. Like you are just person, basically. And then there's also gender fluid, which just means you kind of connect with a bunch of different genders. And sometimes you might feel like more of a woman, you might feel more a man, you might feel non-binary, or you just might be all of those at the same time kind of thing. Let me see if there's any other ones on here.
Thank you. So far, gender fluid is the one that I feel fits best. I'm still looking here. But they're about half of these are so small on my screen, I can't read them, unfortunately.
Yeah, let me see. Can I like?
Oh, thank you.
Did that help?
Yeah, that helps. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Grace. Maybe stop sharing the screen now so we can see everyone if you ask your question. And I'll say what I'm going to be using often is gender expansive, and that's or gender creative. That's a word that Eve specialists are using more and more, and I think it's a good descriptive way to talk about gender expansiveness in general.
Luis has his hand up.
Yes, I thought I'd add a few things based on my understanding. One thing is that traditionally we're used to thinking of gender in the old traditional way of it as categories, that there's a category of males and there's a category of females. But in this new way of looking at gender, it's more It's more using labels instead of categories, and it's very common for people to have more than just one label to describe themselves. The other thing is that, again, from my understanding, this is not some sort of official system of categorizing people. It's more that people are using self-identification. So people will pick the labels that they feel resonate with them or fit with them. So there's an element of subjectivity to these labels. So looking at a chart like this and trying to sort of analyze it and looking at it objectively, figuring out which one is correct and which one is, you know, incorrect, might not sort of grasp the whole essence of this. Thank you.
Thank you. Jessica has your hand up.
Yes, thank you. I believe that in this self-identification, very often we might lose the forest through the trees, in that we're actually discussing gender expression versus gender identity. And we don't necessarily need a whole set of new labels, and this is more opinion. We don't necessarily need a whole new set of labels to describe how we're expressing our gender. You know, we could be tomboys or tomgirls or express our genders however we like. You know, if we're cisgender, if our gender identity isn't distinction, it's just a distinction between gender identity and gender expression.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments?
I just would like to say thank you for everyone like already sharing their experiences. I think it helps because like no experience is going to be the same. So not every like queer person or gender expansive person is going to have the same feelings about certain topics. And I think that's really important. And I also like appreciate all your guys's like contributions, because I think it even helps me think more. So I'll stop sharing this now.
Jessica has your hand up again. Go ahead, Jessica.
I'm sorry. I just never took my hand down. I have nothing further to add. Sorry.
Okay. I want to ask Robert Madden, since he's been in the field forever. Has this issue ever been addressed by Integral? Can you remember people ever addressing this in the past, Robert?
I can't think of anything, but I wouldn't say I know the whole scope of the Integral terrain.
Okay.
Sorry, I have one more question before we move on. So how many people have either gender-expansive people in their lives or are gender-expansive themselves? Just like by a raise of hands. Okay. It seems like almost everyone here. That's cool. So as we go into like this conversation, I think that's important to recognize. Some of us are totally new. Some of us already have some experience. So that's cool.
Thank you, Grace. Thank you so much. And thank you, everybody. When Larry approached me about doing a presentation for San Diego Integral, I really didn't know what to do. But as we saw, we have lots of hands up. This is the language of the future. This is the language of the generations coming up, you know, another kind of social tech, and we're not going to be digital natives here either. So there's a real learning curve. But I was surprised that I never heard a presentation like this. And I have a spiritual principle that if there's something we don't like or we have a complaint about, the only reason we can complain is because we're there, meaning we're part of the system we're complaining about. And therefore, there's hope and empowerment to add to the narrative. So I thought, let me see if me and my children can add to this narrative. And my understanding is this is a San Diego integral first. It's a first. I have no reference point for a presentation like this because I've never been to one. So I really come here with this from a sincere place of not knowing, and I look forward to not knowing together. So when, you know, crafting this presentation, I didn't want to do the PowerPoint presentations showing positive outcomes of gender-affirming care and supportive community and family response, even though such data exists. I don't have a scholarly paper reflecting years of research. So quite honestly, I'm just here with my story. And my story is someone who's been curious about gender expansiveness as a novel cultural emergence and what that means, and the story of being a mother of two gender creative youth. And my story also of someone who has not received a lot of support on this journey of learning how to support my children, both in right-leaning spaces and spiritually progressive and integral spaces. And I know experientially, I understand the lack of support. You know, my story isn't even an exemplary story. As a woman who experienced the constraint of entrenched gender roles, I have always seen the emergence of gender nonconformity as inspiring and evolutionary, full of hope, a third way, as long as it was someone else's kid. And when Ivan came out, my response, quite honestly, was fearful and unskilled. And I was talking to Ivan recently, and I said I'd give myself a D minus. But he assured me that a D minus would be if I threatened to kick him out, and that my response was a solid C. So I heard C's get degrees. So I think I can still get my mom degree. But just to demonstrate the consciousness of these youth, then Ivan not only hasn't held my unskilled response against me, he apologized for maybe the unskilled way he came out. So I want to really bring to the forefront the relational generosity that this generation so easily often conveys. Because truly, my first response is when Ivan came out as trans, I was very distressed by it. You know, I had a long litany of concerns that Ivan was too young to make medical decisions, that he might change his mind and have regret or blame me, that he might experience abuse or bullying, that he might not live a full and happy life. There was some self-centered and personal grief as well. I had distress that I was seeing my strong and gender non-conforming girl join the other team. And when I shared my distress and concerns in the spiritually progressive and integrally minded circles that I found myself in, I was reliably met with quick empathy, and that joining really became a springboard for others to easily share their points of view. And these are the narratives that I've been hearing. I've heard narratives about gender expansiveness being a byproduct of social contagion. I've heard about biological imperatives that are being overlooked, ignorance among care providers, how our youth are confused. I've heard narratives equating medical transitioning with eating disorders, postmodern overreach, stories of tragic detransitioning stories heard online. I've heard narratives like, because I didn't transition 50 years ago and I like myself, today's kids will be better not transitioning as well. And confident predictions that we will see gender expansiveness and medical transitioning as big mistakes in one generation. So seemingly everyone who spoke up, from people I barely knew to lifelong mentors, told me with confidence not to even consider allowing my child to take hormones without ever asking questions about his unique experience or a careful discernment about when hormones might actually be the appropriate choice. And if there were more supportive views in many of the we spaces I found myself in, I really don't know, because with a few exceptions, of course, but the center of gravity is those more positive voices didn't show up. So my children, as I say, evolution is forward. They set me on an evolutionary journey. So I began to examine my biases, my response, my concerns with a therapist who specializes in LGBTQIA plus realities. I began to have courageous conversations with my wise and committedly authentic children. And they showed me a depth of maturity that was very convincing. I looked at pictures of pregnant men and bodies integrating all types of sex-based configurations. I did reading and research, and I started to change. I started to evolve. I started trusting the wisdom of my children. I started to believe that Ivan could make good decisions about his body and his health, even when the stakes were high. I started seeing my children's journey of gender expression with less fear and far more inspiration, really amazed at their capacity to live with such novel countercultural authenticity and a real inspiring freedom. And I even was impressed with their trans-egoic view of family and future and fertility that depended much more on love and connection than on bloodlines or genetics. So as I changed, the stories I told in these same spiritually progressive and integral spaces began to change too. You know, I began to tell the story of Grace's gender fluidity and Ivan's choice to seek out a specialist to medically transition and my own journey of leaning into and embracing new pronouns of acceptance of support. But I noticed something very different. You know, my story of trans and gender affirming acceptance was very often met with silence. Now, there was a polite silence, but there was an absence, maybe no follow-up questions or no joining as people so readily did with my distress, no enthusiasm, and the conversation might continue in a different direction. And in my experience, and I admit I'm only a sample size of one, But pretty much it was those solidly part of the queer community, other parents of trans and non-binary children, a minority of some of my online and integral spiritually progressive communities, and just a few voices that I heard in the larger integral movement really offered actual support and encouragement. Most everywhere else, I experienced silence or even words of caution and disapproval. So quite honestly, I'm just very curious about this. Like, why? Why is this? I don't really know. I could just be wrong, you know, and I take that possibility very seriously. But, you know, why have I not experienced at least more curiosity? Gender expansiveness is what's on the cutting edge of cultural emergence. And isn't that what progressive and integral folk should be most fascinated by? So I'll talk a little bit more about this later, but in general, I see gender expansiveness as evolution in action. Even the language, I move in worlds where so many of us are sincerely aspiring to experience non-duality, where we welcome transcendent state experiences, where we aspire to see how even awareness and the construct of awareness is a binary. And here our youth are literally self-identifying as transgender, transcending gender, and as non-binary. You know, they're saying from the presence of their I am authority, I am non-binary, I am non-dual in the world. And I find this fascinating and exciting. You know, it's almost like rejecting the original sin of patriarchy. And Carol Gilligan describes that as patriarchy as creating gender binaries and then putting them in a value hierarchy. And our youth are seeing these constructs. It's 12, 13, 14 years old, and they're creating evolutionary third ways as a way of transcending and integrating binaries. And I'm really watching this happen. And I've watched my gender nonconforming kids. I've seen their nonconformity spring up from life itself. You know, before they had exposure to social media, without knowing one trans person, there seems to be an intelligence of evolution, a moment in time of allowing, and that's even emerging in a coherent and harmonious way. And something developmental is happening in me as well, as I lean in to my children's changing pronouns, as I learn my unlearn my primary assumptions. I can feel, I start creating new neural pathways as I use the pronouns that my children and their friends prefer. I experience cognitive flexibility as I use new names. And I start seeing almost the reality behind the post-it note of gender that I would otherwise unconsciously place on someone. So from my point of view, evolution is forward and it's speeding up. And in my story, the story of my children are evolving me. And I feel the story of our children and our grandchildren are evolving us, and that we co-evolve. Shusant Trista gave to me here in San Diego Integral what was the most impactful presentation I've heard here. And some of you, I think, were there. You might remember this. He had us fill out demographic questionnaire and then asked us to define integral consciousness. And what emerged was that the most common defining quality of integral consciousness was the capacity to hold multiple perspectives. And while multiple spiritual perspectives were present in our collective, multiple social and biographical perspectives were absent. You know, mostly we were a boomer generation and white. And his teaching was that the questions we most needed to ask to embody our multi-perspectival aspirations are what is present and what is absent, and then make what is absent the focus of our curiosity. So that's one of the questions I want us to consider today. You know, what is absent? And to me, a key perspective that is absent in conversations I've been in about gender expansiveness is the perspective of those people who are gender creative, especially our youth, people who are gender creative, people who are creative with their choices, gender expression, their bodies. I've experienced an absence of conversations curious about the why of gender expansiveness. You know, what is evolution trying to do? Even if we say social contagion is partially at play, and as it was at play in the liberation movement of the 60s, as it's in play in the resurgence of medicine journeys among so many spiritual practitioners I speak to today, you know, why now? And what is its evolutionary purpose? So I'm so grateful for Larry, Kathy, Tom, and Eloy for supporting me, Grace, and Ivan to have such a conversation with all of you tonight. And in particular to you, Grace and Ivan, for agreeing to be with us as well. So what we were going to do now is going to breakout groups and to have a larger conversation. And Ivan, I was wondering if you could, these are questions that Ivan and Grace came up with that they thought would be good for us to discuss. So I'd love it, Ivan, if you'd talk a little bit about the questions, and Grace, if you'd chime in anything that you're inspired to share.
Yeah, so as we break out into breakout groups, some of the questions that you would be asked to answer is, what is your perspective slash story about the culture emergence of gender expansiveness? What biases might you have? How do you fit into the gender expansive movement? Do you feel separate? Does the movement feel other to you? Or do you feel part of it? Have you had a moment in your life where you questioned your sexual orientation or gender identity? And what is absent?
Oh, sorry. So as we break out into groups, me, Ivan, and my mom will be in one of them, I believe, right? This is totally an open space. Just try to practice good faith. And like, it's okay if you're like, oh, I'm not sure if this is like correctly how you say it or something, because we're all learning here. So yeah.
If I may, before we break out, like some groundwork, can we get a clarification from the three of you, distinction between transgender and transsexual, or maybe comparing and contrasting sexual versus gender? I find that a lot of people either conflate them, most do, or they confuse them at least.
Yeah, so from what my knowledge is that the term transsexual is kind of an outdated term that was used to describe transgender individuals like more in the past, but I know some people still do like the term or like still identify as transsexual, but really the term we should all be using when talking about gender is transgender. And yeah, so just if you're talking about what transgender is or people you know, that's, you should just say they are transgender.
Kim, did you have something to say about that, or Jessica? Just unmute and go.
Yeah, so transsexual is very often used by what's now termed a transmedicalist. Very often a very very binary associated male to female or female to male that are rejecting the nonconformity. So there's just like with any movement, they want to kind of shut the door behind them. And so transsexual is kind of taken on a kind of tone around it that is a little bit negative in the trans community. My understanding.
Thank you. Kim has a hand up.
Oh, actually, I just left it up from the prior time, but I will comment. I have a cousin who's transgender, you know, so I've known him since the 70s. He said he knew when he was two, you know, he was assigned female at birth, but he feels male. He transitioned in his 20s, you know, so he lived in Nebraska in a small town, and he's in his 60s now, and he still is male. And, but at that time, you know, they would call it transsexual. I don't think the term transgender had come into usage yet. So I think transgender is just the more current term. And yeah, I think it's considered like not very cool to use the term transsexual because it can be offensive. I'm not quite sure why, but yeah, right. We use transgender in my house.
And you know, Larry, one thing I'll say is, a narrative, I might not be articulating the narrative correctly, but one narrative I've heard in integral spaces is that sex is a biological imperative and gender is fluid. So that there's it's very healthy, this is a narrative, not my opinion, to experiment with gender, but there's no need to actually have to do hormones or a surgery. And it's a distinction I've heard in integral spaces, but when I run it by my kids, they don't resonate with it. It just doesn't land. And I think we've seen this here. So it's a distinction I've heard in the realm of ideas that doesn't seem to translate in the realm of expressed lived reality.
Okay, I'll take us into the breakouts now. There's no other questions.
Breakout sessions are not recorded.
Okay, welcome back, everybody. You know, now's, I think, Tom, do you take over here? Is this the time for some open sharing?
Yeah. So why don't we open it up to whatever you learned in it? Maybe I'll preface it with, I didn't get a chance to say this in my group, there's too many questions, but we had, Carol was in my group, and the reason I remark about it is we've been around since the 50s, and the rate of change, you know, what is absent, we asked ourselves, and the rate of change going through civil rights, femininity, feminism, introduction of homosexuality, environmentalism. There's an exhaustion in the loss of form. And I want to express that, not that I want to inhibit this next growth process, but there's a bit of an exhaustion in how much has changed for so long. When you think of the Dark Ages, 800 years, nothing changed basically between Augustine and the Italian Renaissance. And Karen can debate that with me later on. But here we are in 50, 60 years, and the rate of change is extraordinary to the better, I would dare say, but it is exhausting. But that said, what did you experience in your breakout room? Just jump in.
Okay, we had a really lively discussion, and I will keep this brief because I want very much to hear what Susanna has to say too. But one of the comments Finley made was that if we get rid of the binaries and kind of open the way to more, I guess I'll use the term fluidity. And I'm thinking in terms of, you know, the polarity work that we're doing in the integral community, seeing this as a polarity, a fluid dynamic back and forth rather than absolute. But what I wanted to, didn't quite get a chance to when our breakout room closed, I wanted to say that the binary is one of the defining features of the pre-modern, and that is a separate period, Tom. We'll debate about the Middle Ages. A lot happened in that 800 years. It is its own separate period. It correlates in Ken Wilber's Up from Eden, correlates with concrete operational phase of individual development. The whole culture in a medieval pre-modern traditional religion, you know, the monisms and monotheisms, it's a very binary way of thinking. That is one of the definitive features. And this is why, I'll just say this briefly and drop it, we have the 1/3 of the population of the United States that is still, you know, functioning rational adults, but they're in that mindset. They see the world in terms of binaries. This move, although it's evolutionary and necessary and wonderful and positive, it terrifies them, which is among the reasons they're acting so badly. And among our challenges as we evolve further is to how to understand ourselves and each other and society in ways that is less to help them be less terrified. That's among the challenges that face us as we evolve. And I will hand the talking stick to Suzanne.
As most of the times, it was way too short a time. I was very touched and impressed with the maturity of the two women I was with. And that is to me one of the issues, and you touched upon it a bit, Karen. It's a developmental thing as well. Mature people in these, around these discussions, can really find themselves in whichever way they can and be proud and happy with what they find and create. But the less mature ones are just totally confused. And there's a lot of pressure to keep the old ways, the clean old binary going. And we see that in the legal system. We see that all over. So how can we have the compassion, and I would really here use the two terms, feminine and masculine compassion, which has nothing to do with gender, but with the attitude, whether you're embracing and whether you can make set clear boundaries, that those are also in play. Let's really work, at least for me, I have to constantly remind me of that. Try to stay open, as you said. Where are you now? Oh, I have the person who introduced her children. Where are you?
Shara, right here.
Hi, Shara. that is wonderful, and I can see your children blossoming under your care and guidance. But so many children don't have that, and my heart goes out to them. So, I just came because I really do think we have to engage with this topics, whether we like it or not. It's the way of how things go now, and it's let's make sure that everyone can be well and happy and free in what they choose.
How are you? Look like you want to react.
So I was in Susan's group. This is Jessica. I want to speak to, first, I'm grateful that you spoke to the level of maturity, because I was going to say every ounce of maturity was required, because what started to evolve was the polarity or the debate between the gender critical feminists and trans women. And what ends up occurring is the fear of the annihilation of the other, whereas the gender critical can hold a view that a trans woman is not a woman, and a trans woman would look at gender critical as wanting to not be seen as a woman and wanting to be erased. And they both, so it's a very difficult debate to have, and I appreciate the individual that I was speaking with, as I disagree just wholeheartedly on that space. And I think I would love to touch base with that person offline for further discussion if they are open to it.
I'm not sure who went first, Tamar or Luis had the hand up first. Go ahead, you start talking, Tamar.
I think it was Tamar who was first.
Okay. So I just wanted to connect with what you said, Tom, about this rapid change, and Suzanne. And I came to America in 76, and the Americas that I saw was ruled by Orange. And Orange created all the institutes that hold our society. Also, most of the society, as we know from the statistics, is amber or below. And I think that everybody went with this because science, I was born in 1842, where my mother still washed her laundry in her hands and stuff, and all the appliances, everything that science created brought, you know, such an advantage and relief and raising the standard of living, whatever. So everybody accepted democracy or science, even if they don't know or really internalize the principle or whatever. But what happened that at certain point, what was, heaven on earth become to be a disaster when those people who felt great, and I believe that these people who are now want to have America great again, this is a time that they remember. Because everybody says that America is so great, even blue worker are, middle class. Now they're not. So you have terrible social change, but a lot of people that once felt kind of proud part of America, it's probably mostly white male, but not always, only now are feeling terrible. And now you add to this all the social change, like green was far beyond what they could have accepted. And with all the values of green, it came and pushed into education, to all the institutions, they are scared. They are definitely scared, and I can relate to this. And that's why they want the America that they remember, that when I came here in the 70s or until the middle 80s, and these kids were not even born probably there by then, so they don't remember this kind of America. And I understand why they're scared. And I was always, when I saw all this running, I was scared all the time. I said, hold it, don't push so hard on everything. But yeah, and I don't know. We need to strengthen, Orange, because this, if Orange falls, we will not be able to even speak, have these conversations anymore. And I don't know how to do it and how to make development and still not frighten them. And this is the main thing that we need to think about, I think.
Sounds Keegan-esque at IEC last year. Louise.
Yes, I thought I'd add a few things based on my own thoughts about how this topic is relevant for integral. When I've heard the topic described in various integral contexts, there's often been a tendency of talking about these modern perspectives of gender as something, you know, other than integral, that it's something that's going on in green, or it's something that's going on with the youth, or something similar. And I really don't think that's true. I think it's something that's incredibly relevant for anybody who's interested in an integral understanding of things. And looking at the topics being discussed in integral, I think all the time I've been involved in integral, gender has been one of the most kind of favorite topics in integral, but it's always been kind of only going so far. It's looking at kind of like polarity and masculine and feminine. And this whole time, this past 20 years, there's been this whole thing unfolding mostly within the confines of green meme. And integral has pretty much just been ignoring it. So I think it's about due time. And I wanted to point out a couple of traits of what's going on that I think is about as integral as anything can get. One of the things is this thing with transcend and include. What's going on with the modern perspectives of gender is very much a deconstruction of the old norms of gender, but it's also reconstructing the parts as something new, which is pretty much what integral is all about. So it's just not just a green meme thing. There's a lot of constructing something new going on in it as well. Another very integral trait when it's come to the personal level is this whole notion of turning what is subjective into something objective. And I think for all of us, or most of us, sex and our gender is something that is subjective. It's not something we're used to looking at from the outside and asking critical questions about. But I've learned from my journey through this that it brings a whole new perspective to it. And a lot of the experiences I've had has had this, I've had this experience of turning something very subjective into an objective thing. It might be natural if for anybody who's not gender non-conforming to think that this is only about understanding what other people are going through. But for all of us, when we encounter somebody else, someone else, or talk with someone else, we see them and encounter them through the filter of gender. And if you think that, I don't really do that, I can share my experience of when I started to join a group of trans people. And when I got into this space of people who were really all genders, but also people who were in different stages of transition. And for the first couple of meetings, my thinking brain was just running in overdrive, trying to put people into boxes and trying to figure out what was going on. And then after a while, I just gave up and had to just see what people were presenting to me and not trying to, you know, fit them into a box. And that experience has been very valuable for me, but it also taught me something about how deeply ingrained it is for us to see people through the filter of gender.
Great points, Louise. Integral has shadow. Who would have suspected that? Real quick comments, though, because we want to do another breakout. Larry's next.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. As Tom and Shara in particular know, I've had extensive conversations with each of them about my own experiences around gender issues, sex issues, and whatnot. And regardless of anybody's take on the whole thing, what I find is most important is, can we all agree that what's paramount in the discussion is the mental health of adults and children? I don't have a problem with people who are transgender, as Jessica Gold knows. And I don't have a problem necessarily with children who are exploring this. I think that our evolution as a species and how that's playing down in consciousness, especially from an integral perspective, especially from a construct aware perspective, looking at these things is very important. And I went through that process for myself. Am I gay? Am I straight? You know, as the feminine became more alive in me from my own evolution. And I think it's very important to realize there's kind of three things that kind of help clarify it for me, so it doesn't stay in the realm of like confusion. There's sex, there's sexual orientation, and then there's gender identity. Sex is physical, and gender identity is more mental. And it's easy to conflate those two, especially for kids who their brains haven't developed fully, which doesn't happen until around age 25, according to the studies. And so we want to have compassion for this whole thing. And we want to take care of the kids who are having any dysphoria around this, their gender identity or their identity in general, regardless of gender. And it's not easy stuff. And I'm impressed with Shara and her two kids, at least as the way they're showing up here. I'm sensing mental health there. That's beautiful. I do have a lot of reluctance about kids that are considering, or worse yet, doing hormone therapy, especially if they want to get into surgeries and make physical changes. I've watched a lot of videos of detransitioners, and my heart goes out to them because they got swept up in the whole gender grooming movement that seems to be in so many spaces, especially in schools, especially on TikTok. Oh my God. So I'm all about mental health, trying to get at that, you know, what that's going to look like, especially for kids. Enough for now.
Okay, real quick, Finley, quick, we're running out of time.
Yeah, thanks, Eloy. I just want to underline what Louise is saying too. I'm really enjoying that at the moment with all the young people putting me in this position of arresting my projections or my trying to find the story and just taking them as they are. And for that to be somehow the exploration between, as well, between interiors and exteriors, and how they're actually, the correlations might also be quite fluid in those terms. And also to say to Ivan and Grace that this is feels to me like, you know, with my kids too, who are still teenagers, who are in this world and who still haven't settled particularly, the conversation that you're having with yourselves and with everybody of this fluidity is really the service, you know, to evolving everybody. So thank you for that. Thank you.
All projection. Grace, final word, we're going to break out.
Okay. This is kind of just adding on to what everyone has contributed so far. But I kind of see, like, the whole conversation around gender expansiveness as less, like, I feel like it's usually portrayed as an argument. Like, oh, is this right or is this wrong? But really, I feel like it's about the individual and like working on the self, because we all have like kind of ingrained biases. And like I even had them like when I was a kid due to society or other things like that. And you kind of have to acknowledge them and kind of work on yourself. Like I was able to experience this when I was a lot younger, so I think it was a lot easier to me, but there was a time where I was kind of like, why, like, I don't want to, like, work through all this right now. Like, I don't want all this stuff to be new. And this is a little off topic, but I've recently been taking a political science class. And it's really interesting how, honestly, in political science, you understand the like philosophy behind people even more than like a philosophy class. And so I know that Luis has been talking about like categorizing. And like, when I was always like, we talk about biases and things like that, I'd be like, well, where do they come from? Like, where does a bias, like, why do we as humans sometimes just have this innate want to categorize things? And it honestly comes down to what I think as like, kind of our instincts. Like, I use the example of categorizing a lion, like as dangerous, and then we survive because we always categorize that lion as dangerous. But now we categorize things that don't need to be categorized and actually inhibit us from becoming better humans and evolving to the next level. So that's just my take on it, that it's actually more of like a self-assessment, this whole like gender expansiveness, than an assessment of if other people are doing the right thing. So yeah.
Okay, I hate to slow this conversation down. It's just buzzing.
Thank you, Tom. You know, we actually don't, we're not even ready for the breakout questions because Ivan has something, and then I was going to actually present something and then go into the breakout group. So I don't know, maybe I want Ivan to present his, and then maybe I'll do an abridged presentation. And we're a small enough group that the next breakout questions, maybe we can do during social hour or something. What do you think of that?
I'm fine. Okay. The fluidity of it all.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. Let's embody it. Ivan, please share your screen.
I made a short like video that shows trans beauty and different people expressing their identity. And I just think it's important to see it because there's so many different ways of expressing yourself. And in this video, it only shows a couple out of the many that there are. But yeah, I'll share my screen now.
Prone to second guessing it. Hey, pretty smiling people, we're all right together. We're all right together. Hey, pretty shining people, we're all right together. We're all right together. Hey. Took it in turn to dream about the lottery, what we might have done if we had entered and had won it. We're each convinced that nothing would have changed, but if this were the case, why is it a conversation anyway? Are we losing touch? Are we losing touch now? He said, why, what a terrible time to be alive if you're prone to overthinking.
Thank you, Ivan. That was wonderful, really. Just a statistic that Ivan's specialist told us was that there was this a rising of left-handedness. You know, left-handedness was always considered to be sinister and therefore suppressed. And between 1910 and 1980, the number of left-handed people increased from 3% to 12%. So we have to look at transgender people have always existed. And now that there's the cultural space for that expression to come out, we're likely to see it more and more. And and I think the left-handedness statistic is very helpful. But I really want to turn our focus on tonight's headline question. You know, could gender expansiveness be evolution's move to non-duality? And even could it be an exterior manifestation of our interior work to see through the eyes of non-dual consciousness? You know, could our work actually be related? And Carol Gilligan, of course, researches the transition of outspoken girls into adolescents who begin to present with depression, eating disorders, anxiety. And she talks about adolescence initiates girls into a reality where to be in relationship with others, the cultural price is to silence the voice that stands up for what they believe in. And healthy development collides with patriarchy, which divides girls into good girls who are selfless and bad girls who are not. And this causes psychological distress. And our intervention is to join in healthy resistance. So in a sense, with the failure of feminism in many ways, could gender expansiveness be an evolutionary form of healthy resistance? You know, another way to frame this question, if we're not supportive of the rise in expansive gender expression, which may or may not include medical transitioning, are we corralling our youth to a developmental track that disrupts healthy development in both males and females? So I think this is a real dilemma. If we don't support our youth, we may be supporting narratives that require them to move forward in the developmental status quo. We actually may be asking them to adapt to persistent patriarchy. And again, Gilligan says that's simply a system that creates binaries, such as care is justice, genders them, and put them in a value hierarchy, as we see in the salaries of caregivers and educators. The impact is a society that hurts all gender expressions, where males are taught to disconnect from self, females are taught to become selfless, and that prevents deep intimacy from both sexes because no one's at home. So as a mother, I'm very excited to see a third way emerging for all children and for us all. I also see gender expansiveness is creating the type of complex environments that support development for all of us. You know, what's astonishing to me is how our gender expansive youth are asking us to accommodate them by being called by their preferred pronouns, which really requires us to change our habitual patterns and hardwiring. It took me months to get my children's pronoun consistently correct. And they're asking us to do this work, to adapt, to change our language. And I don't know about you, but as a youth, I couldn't even ask my dad to roll down his window when he was smoking in the car. So as evolution moves forward and speeds up, it's only fitting that we allow our youth to influence us so we can all co-evolve. Jim Lockard teaches spiral dynamics for new thought, for the new thought movement. And he reports that transgender individuals have always existed, have the right to exist. And he acknowledges, as we're talking here, that identification as transgender is highly complex. And that only because society has reached stages of higher complexity can transgender identity really come online. But he says that because it's so complex, transgender identity will be out of sync with our cultural centers of gravity. Most people simply don't have the developmental capacity to see transgender identity as legitimate, and it's almost a developmental incommensurability that's creating some of the reactivity and evolutionary tension. And this is the quandary that I think Suzanne was talking about, and how do we have compassion and help move things forward? And I think Grace was getting at this. I think one way we move it forward is to focus on, let's say, as an integral community, what are we for? And get coherent on that message. Because while it's easy to talk about what is happening, let's say, in the right, it's very hard to articulate really where we stand. And in my experience, I've been kind of lonely on this journey, even in integral spaces. So whatever the presumed level of gender expansiveness is emerging from, you know, what is an appropriate integral response?
You know, is it to pay attention to individual and collective subjective experiences while being curious about their meaning making, while studying data, allowing research to help inform best practices? How do we really look at this in a thoughtful way? Because this is a highly relevant topic for our community. Let's see. A couple of other things I'll say is, you know, one of the main tenets of evolutionary spirituality is that consciousness evolves in the direction of greater complexity, while also emerging as greater expressions of differentiation and cohesion. So if something is truly evolutionary, which I believe gender expansiveness is, perhaps we should have some developmental humility and realize that novel emergence will be a challenge for most of us. So whatever the genesis, whether it's biological or social or both, those who are gender expansive, they know their worlds, and their perspective of their worlds are the ones that I think we need to give more valence to. And finally, and I'm kind of abridging things here, but I'd like to just muse on the nonlinear relationship of evolution. You know, ultimately, it's awareness that transcends all binaries, and in non-dual awareness, all duality is reconciled. And I do wonder, could it be that non-dual awareness is culturally outpicturing as non-binary identification? You know, could our work even be related in a quantum evolutionary way?
Would you restate that, Shara? That sounded really good. I want to make sure I got my arms around it.
Well, I wonder, like, if we're looking at interior and exterior quadrants, that is there a way that some of our work to transcend binaries in non-dual awareness, where really duality has a reconciliation, could it be that that interior process is culturally outpicturing as non-binary identifications, as transgender, as gender fluid, as gender expansive and creative? You know, could our work actually be related? I wonder about that. To me, that seems possible. You know, like in a non-dual space, even the binary of I am and I am not is transcended. And we can see as essence through essence itself. And Louise, I think you were talking about this. I wanna share a story about how pronouns led to a state experience in Grace. So I was telling Grace that I sometimes have the experience of calling a cisgender person by their correct pronoun. For example, like calling a woman she. And then I have this moment of disorientation that maybe I misgendered them. And Grace told me, she said, Mom, this is great progress. And that sometimes they have a practice where Grace says they intentionally look at people, even clearly cisgendered people, as if they do not know what their gender is. And then Grace told me hesitantly, but enthusiastically, they said, Mom, when I purposely look at cisgender people as if I do not know their gender, and they say to me, I know this is going to sound weird, it might even sound crazy, but sometimes I can see their essence. So to me, Grace was describing a state experience. And I think there our work could be related. And by unlearning gender and seeing beyond gender or beneath gender or before gender, our youth are intuitively gauging in spiritual practice that helps us offer glimpses of essence itself. So, you know, Genesis 1, the first creation story before binaries are introduced to Genesis 2. Genesis 1, it's all good. It said that humanity was created in God's own image and that male and female God created them. The pronoun is ambiguous. Male and female, God created them. And male and female is the original image of God, you know, using they, them pronouns. Think what would evolution have been if God was a they from the beginning? And I like the thought experiment that maybe the gender expansive movement is moving us closer to a conscious Garden of Eden where binaries are once again reconciled and with more and more people saying we are non-binary, we are transgender. You know, perhaps there's something happening in this And we're moving to this reconciliation and into the mystery that could even be a transgender God on some level. So I have more, but those are just some musings because I know we're moving in on time, and maybe we can do a quick breakout group and then come back for a social hour. Does that sound pretty good? Okay, so I'll tell you the questions now. I'll put them in the chat. So the questions we're going to be considering, let me do this right here, is could gender expansiveness be evolution's move to non-duality? Could non-dual awareness and non-binary identification be related? And if, even if you don't believe this, okay, so if, even as a thought experiment, we try on the perspective that gender expansiveness is a manifestation of healthy cultural evolution, what do you see? Okay.
All right. Are we ready? We're going to have to do a short breakout, but we can discuss it in the social half hour after. So I think we're ready to go, Eli. Hey, welcome back, everyone. How good has this session been?
Tom, thank you for hosting, and Shara, thank you very much. I am in the UK and it's now 3 minutes past two in the morning, so I'm going to step out before it gets interesting again. I've really enjoyed this. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Finley. Bye.
See you later. Bye.
So we've come to the end of our meeting and it's final wrap up. Thank you, our presenters. This was a very energetic session. You really did an amazing job. And why wouldn't it be? It really ticks off certain segments of people that are having difficulty entering it. And I love the question is it an accelerant towards non-duality? It certainly is. We don't want to limit it because it will limit our capability along many dimensions, including the spirituality. So where can they learn more about your work, Shara?
I need co-collaborators. I don't have work. I'm a Unity minister. I don't have an answer for that. I mean, I wouldn't say go listen to my talks on Sunday because it's not necessarily about this. I would just say, let's keep the conversation alive and be in the inquiry of what's happening here and keep deep curiosity alive. And maybe even, that would be my best answer.
Yeah, I'll throw out an invitation that we could revisit this at some point in the future and see what's changed in a few months.
And you can always come back to San Diego Into to see Shara. She's usually here and contributes tons of stuff. So to remind you, next month, November 11th, always the second Saturday every month, we meet at this time. Eventually, we're going to try to meet earlier in the morning so people don't have to be up after midnight in Europe when they visit us. But we haven't pulled that together yet. Don't forget to visit our website. Please RSVPI online. And where you can make a donation also. So we're moving to the informal chat segment right now. And just feel free to pop up and discuss it. I thought I would reiterate something Karen Voorhees said in our last breakout group, if you're okay with me doing that, Karen, is remember Salman Rushdie when he wrote the satanic verses? He was given a death sentence because in the book, he asked, how does newness enter our current schemata of the world? And they thought they already knew everything that was divine. And it was that simple area that he challenged existing dogma that got him the death sentence. So you can see the level of resistance to change, especially when change alters form to such an extensiveness. I thought that was a brilliant quote, Karen. Do you have more to add to that?
The surface reason that was given was because Salman Rushdie dared to put forth a premise that's very hidden in Islamic scholarly circles, that some verses of the Quran were actually slipped in by the devil, because basically Muhammad kind of channeled the Quran. It was dictated to him. But there was this subversive heresy that held that some of the devil slipped in a few of the verses. So that was hence the title of the novel, The Satanic Verses, because that was mentioned in the course of the novel. But what the novel was really about, the theme that he announced front up and kept coming back to through this amazing story he told, was how does newness enter the world? That was what, who was it who said, Whitehead said, the creative advance into novelty, evolution. This is why evolution is one of the core themes of the religious conservatives in our part of the world. I mean, this is one of the hinges between the pre-modern and the modern world, is admitting that something new can replace what exists. This is one of the key things that challenges the pre-modern strata, which is what I think I read in Ken Wilber, that's like 70% of the world's population, 30 to 35% in the United States. These people are with us, and they're our brothers and sisters, and they're terrified. And somehow, even as we open into these wonderful new vistas that are opening ahead of us, somehow we have to, while we're transcending, somehow we have to include these people in our hearts too, and keep them from doing too much damage. So that is part of the challenge. It's complex.
Other thoughts?
I just wanted to interject that the idea of non-binary is maybe new to the Western society, but like in Chinese society, we have the idea of yin and yang that have this idea. That doesn't mean that most of the society was developed or whatever. And even in the native, I think it's mostly South America, there is a myth of the eagle and the condor. And when they fly together, eagle is a symbol of male and the masculine, condors feminine, and then they fly together, the world become better. So the idea of integration of the, well, it's maybe new to the Western world. It's both either or, other than either and. But it's not, totally new idea for the human society. And to me, it's more not either or, but just the integration of both of them and having the good size of, because we have our images of what is what, right? And it's fairly universal, but the integration of both principle, yeah, is a way to non-duality. And we have to agree that everybody kind of have either both of them in kind of different, amounts. I'm still maybe biased about the medical stuff. Yeah, this is a totally different story, because it's not the analogy of the leftist and right, this is more like, to me, like integration of the idea or letting everybody be who they are. But this is how they born, right? They didn't change hormone or didn't do any surgery to become left-righted, right? But I'm very concerned about the medical. Maybe it's biased, but that's where I come from.
Yeah, I have a concern about the medical as well. Especially around the notion of trying to work the non-dual and evolutionary into it. I could see the transgender notion of the spectrum of gender, so to speak, or non-gender even, because I really think as souls, we don't have gender before we come into embodiment. But the idea of transitioning medically from one sex to the other, that's still binary. That still keeps it in the realm of binary. It doesn't handle the issue of being more pluralistic in terms of gender, the gender being an identity. It's a mental thing.
You can still transition, and you can transition and be something what's called transmasculine or transfeminine. You can still be non-binary and go through a sort of transition. So it doesn't necessarily imply a binary, but it can times.
I agree. Yeah, I'm thinking of the kids in the videos I've seen of the detransitioners, where they thought their answer of mental well-being was to change their sex. Not just their gender identity, but their sex, and how abused they felt by the system of the people that talked them into doing that, because they just were confused and they couldn't figure it out. And they found a bunch of what I call bad actors, especially on TikTok and various YouTube channels, that pulled them that way, you know, gave them the attention they needed. We all want attention for sure. Just pull them that way. So I think there needs to be compassion and sensitivity and nuance and how to sense into all this, so that children, especially adults, they can take care of themselves, make all the transitions you want in whatever kind of way. But children in particular, since their brains aren't developed yet, it's they're going to be changing their minds as they grow. They can't not, especially if they're evolutional. And how can we support them in getting clearer in their confusion, be it gender dysphoria or any other kind of confusion from just being a child? Hell, there are adults in the world that are very confused now, given the way the world is. So it's not a gender issue or a child issue even.
So just jump in. This is Homo segment.
Okay, I'll jump in. I had my hand raised, but I'll jump in. I think in terms of evolution, we've learned that non-duality includes duality. It's transcend and include. So it's not that we want to be non-binary. We want to be able to dance between the two and then create that sacred third. You know, so I think that the term non-duality and even non-binary is a little problematic for me anyway, in terms of evolution. Thank you.
Can please, I kind of jump in?
Please jump in. You've had your hand up a while.
I would really like to jump in.
Yeah, Louise is next.
Thank you. First, I'd like to mention a kind of bigger point in this, which is that for anybody who's genuinely curious about this subject, to try and seek out sources who have lived experience with this and who are talking about it on their own terms, on their own platform. Because unfortunately, what we see in the general media is media outlets who are focused on what generates clicks, what generates emotion, and then they tend to look at all the controversial things, they look at all the problems. I put some links in chat, which I think are pretty high quality sources, which come from a strong philosophical background, all of them, and they are all transgender themselves. The first three are what I would call major sources, and the fourth is somebody who's from the integral community, who used to be a very active community member, but kind of left the integral because they kind of gave up on integral in that part. About this whole talk about transgender children and how do we assist them the most and how do we help the most, I think it's important. I think everybody agrees that access to more counseling, more access to more information is incredibly important, but it's also important to know that this group of detransitioners who's being promoted a lot in the media is a very, very small group. All statistics say that it's like only 1 or 2% of people who transition who have regrets. And out of the people who have regrets, most of them have regrets because of the social stigma and the the response they see from society and how hard it is to live as a transgender person. And of the remaining detransitioners, a good amount of them are still gender non-confirming, but they started to transition at a time when there wasn't really good advice to be giving out. So it's a complex subject, and there's a lot of perspectives and nuances in that. And again, I would really recommend to try and listen to some sources who have lived experiences and are not being promoted by some sort of political outlet or political platform.
I wanted to talk about the concerns about youth medically transitioning, because I'm the youth and I'm medically transitioning. I started hormones when I was 15, and I do get a lot of questions and comments like, you're way too young to know who you are and you're gonna regret it, and you need help. But I think that the help that I need is the hormones, because my journey has been long, and at a certain point it's I'm stuck and I need a next step, and that next step is having a place that can make me more love myself even more, because dysphoria I feel like can't be fixed. It can, but testosterone for me will help that. It won't cure it, not like it's a illness. What am I trying to go at? I don't know. I feel like the concerns about the youth transitioning is difficult, because it's also not the media, because the media does portray detransitioning, because that's the only thing it talks about. But then on the other side, it shows how happy trans people are and how much medically transitioning really helps mental health and yourself, because dysphoria is formed by not liking your body or yourself, and testosterone masculinizes your features, so it helps you love yourself more. And I'm grateful that sources in New Mexico help the youth.
What a blessing, Ivan, that you're able to have access at this age. I feel warmth in my heart to know that you have that availability. To speak more to the detransitioning, I think, Louise, you really hit on some good points around that. Number one, the research, 1-2%, very powerful research. Of those, discussing the idea that a lot of them, social pressures, difficulty, financial access, but even greater than that, I think what we're also seeing is with the detransitioning videos and such, of course, with the promoting on the right side of the political spectrum, and these are real cases that need real compassion, but I'm sorry, these are not transgender people, and so it's not a transgender problem. So I don't know that that's being discussed in the zeitgeist, that the people that are detransitioning that are not transgender are not transgender. And these numbers are incredibly low when you compare it to any regret level of any surgery or any medical intervention out there. And so we don't see anybody out there raising any flags around cosmetic surgeries or hip surgeries or spine surgeries that people regret at astronomically higher rates, that are ruining people's lives at the same level. And so you're only seeing it through this transgender lens that something is amiss and there are people coming out and having concerns for the youth. This is just, I'm sorry, this is it's a farce. for lack of a better term, I'm searching for a different term. Thank you.
It's not, I don't think it's done in good faith, and it's very much just cherry picked kind of thing. I guess from my point of view, you know, I appreciate the tone set by the presenters today, and just it feels good to talk about this and to talk about, you know, gender expansion and non-binary identities as a positive thing. But then again, we see like getting slogged down in whether something exists or not, or this sort of existential crisis. It's just like, feel like taking a step forward and then taking a step back. But I do want to acknowledge the way that these identities were seen in a positive way, because the dominant narrative seems like is with non-binary identities, it's like, oh, you know, do they exist or not? You know, and that's kind of, it's a tough thing to, as a non-binary person, to navigate the world with that being kind of the main conversation. But I appreciate the presenters saying, you know, this does exist, and it can be positive to be a person with this identity. But it's tough to move forward that when there's so much doubt about it, and then getting dragged back down into these conversations about, you know, all these different things. But I get it. Again, people don't always have the truth, and there's a lot of misinformation and cherry picking. So people are gonna delay the progress that we're gonna make, because some people are not, they're afraid of it.
Grace, please jump in.
Yeah, so I know we could talk about medical transitioning all night, because it's a very highly controversial topic. And I know there's mainly a lot of strong opinions about it, but personally, I don't find it a very, a topic of a conversation that improves this, like furthers our insight on what being transgender is, and kind of furthers this conversation. Like, it's one of those conversations that whenever I have them or I hear about them, it's just like a loop. And so while I think this conversation was great, I would kind of like to move on back to the focus, or like the title of this presentation, and kind of go back to, oh no, I think she left. She was talking about her opinions on how she was, maybe she didn't like the opinions that like non-duality, it's moving to non-duality, but instead it's moving to two things and that. And I really like that perspective, because honestly, personally, I was a little confused on what non-duality meant. And I probably should have asked my mom a bit more about that beforehand, because she uses it a lot. But I really like that perspective, because it's not erasure of everything we know. It's about building off of what we already have. And that's really what I think is like the best thing about like growing as a community and humanity. It's just building off what we already have, not changing completely what we have. So, and we always have room to build more off of. So I just kind of wanted to ask, if like bring the conversation back to that and ask like other people's thoughts on like their opinions of non-duality, and whether that means like building off what we already have, or like complete erasure of what we already know to exist.
Wow. Transcend and include.
Yeah, I think it could be all that. Again, yeah. It comes down to what promotes mental health and well-being. So I'm not for or against transitioning. What promotes mental health and well-being? And like Shara presented beautifully in how she opened into this, is how can we be present to this, to and be open to it, and explore it in ways that we serve ourselves and we serve each other and our mental health and well-being.
Yeah, as a cultural historian, I say every one of the levels of human civilization has added something essential that was necessary, absolutely necessary, for the next level beyond it to evolve out of it. And we tend to, I don't know how much you folks are into integral theory, but in what we call first tier, the first six stages of human society up through postmodern, we have tended not to be able to see the validity of levels of other than our own. So we tend to demonize the levels past and only see their negatives and forget about the positives. But as I see it, and I've reading Ken Wilber a long time, that every one of those previous six stages has had something absolutely essential that we need. It's like a pyramid. You know, you need the levels. The levels above may be more complex and higher up, but they can't be stable without the levels below them. So this is the mantra: transcend and include. I mean, totally what you said, Grace. We need what we have now, leaving outside the negative parts, the demonizing of the other, and moving forward, keeping what is good and true and beautiful of the past and the present as we move into the future, into what is the next level of the good, the true, and the beautiful, and somehow embracing it all. And I see just about the non-dual, that's a very abstract term, but the non-dual embraces the duality. And as we grow further towards it, we become more fluid in our ability to move back and forth between, we see them as polarities. That we move back and forth. Like my mental model for it, and I know Nomali's familiar with this, that a duality is a polarity, like a North Pole and a South Pole. You have to have both to have a magnetic field, to have something happening. And so we become more agile in our ability to move back and forth between the two as appropriate. And that's my sense of duality in this context.
Go ahead.
Sorry. I just wanted to say I really liked that perspective coming from like a historical context. I think that's really interesting. Yeah.
To me, this conversation, I'm not even quite sure it takes the model of duality a different place to me. It's like, it's not just a duality. It's like, I think I said something in one of the breakouts about possibility. It's like, it's not just either or the range in between. It's like outside of that, it feels like it could take us outside of that to different possibilities.
Yeah, Eloy was saying that in our breakout group, and I could feel it. Like, you know, what's it like to get a sense of being beyond, lack of a better word, gender constructs at 15 years old? You know, like what becomes possible from these fields of consciousness that something comes online so early? And something new, a new story can emerge, a new human story.
Yeah, what's important for me is that this unfolding of evolution in the area of gender, that it's about moving towards something, not moving just away from something. Like a young lady, you know, having bad experience as a young lady or as a girl, and not wanting to be like a girl anymore, wanting to be more like a boy, because she'll feel safer that way, and vice versa. For boys wanting to be more like a girl, that's usually less the case. But yeah, so how is it moving towards something, and enacting a healthy expression of just humanity's consciousness evolving?
I have a dumb question. I don't know if we focus on gender or whatever should become such a central point that this is not the only basis for identity. This is only one basis. And I guess to be transgender force you to almost think all the time about it because of the medical, social, whatever implication that it has. And I wonder if it doesn't hurt other facets of your development, because everybody is this age, you know, even if they don't think about it, well, everybody think about how to behave, you know, to fit in and all that stuff. But there are so many other things that are connected with development. And my concern is that putting so much attention just about the gender stuff just make you forget that there are other things of humanity, being human, that you need to develop. Just, and I, this is a question, not a critique.
There's over 500 bills restricting transgender individuals in our country right now, and so it's being weaponized on the right, and of course it's more complex than that, but that's a big portion of why we're talking about it a lot.
And especially why we're talking about it in this meeting, because that's the topic of this meeting.
Yeah, I would love to kind of give my thought on that question, and kind of go off Larry's, like, kind of point that, like, if you're a girl, you don't want to be a girl because you're not treated well. So why wouldn't you be a boy? But that does sound like kind of restricting in a way, like you're just conforming to what's already there. So it's really kind of what I see it as is like a collective thing. So when I grew up, gender was a bigger discussion than I know it was, like, thought for me, than I know it was from even just my mom. And I value that. I value that I was in a space where I could question beliefs and beliefs about society. And I think because when you start questioning your own self, you're then more sure of yourself. So this is why I even think that if you're cisgender, that means you assign with the gender you're born with. If you're straight, you should still have an experience where you go through a process of thinking about it. Because even if it's on your mind all the time, it really, once you come out of it, you're so much more sure of yourself. And I think that helps everyone around you. Because when you're insecure about yourself, you get things, I feel like patriarchy. You get these like societal things that push other people down because you don't really know who you are as a person yourself. So just like, I don't think thinking about your gender a lot is a bad thing, because I actually think it makes you more empathetic towards other people because you are more grounded in yourself as a person.
Well, to me, it's strange because, well, I grew up in Israel, and one of my sociology professors kind of joked that they teach girls that they are equal to boys until they come to the real world and they see that it's not this way. So for me, growing up, I didn't feel any bad thing about being a girl. And that's why my experience is different. Just, you know, just to clarify.
I'd like to make the distinction, though, this uncomfortableness for a girl growing up to want to feel more safe as a boy. Again, I would love to make the distinction. This has nothing to do with being transgender.
Right.
I'd like to say, too, you know, the temptation to, I really appreciate, Grace, your tenacity to keep us on an introspective point. Because the temptation to talk about something actually relieves us of that deeper inquiry to come to a new understanding of our own experience and evolution. So, like, I even wonder, the control freak in me, like, if we did another presentation like this, to almost make it explicit that we would not allow each other to talk about what the right's doing, talk about statistics, but really talk about our own our own experience, what we have as bias, what we don't have as bias, what we see in the moment emerging from the we space of intentional communication as a way to stop energy leaks in a topic like this.
Yeah, that's interesting, because I remember before this, when we're planning it, I actually was like, should we say not to bring up certain points? just because I know from experience, they just go in circles. And while I'm not saying they're not important conversations to have, I just don't think all of us are at a point where we can allow that space to be there and have good faith in each other that we can reach a compromise with each other. And so it's really interesting. And I think that's part of like the working on ourselves. Like when someone brings up this triggering topic, feel it like in your body and feel what's triggering you, like what's activated. And then reflect, why is this so activating for me right now? And there doesn't have to be a logical reasoning behind it. You can just start to think about your past experiences or things you've heard or from other people and just really think, oh, this is why I'm triggered by this topic or why it like creates a reaction inside of me. And that's really what I feel like is what this gender expansiveness is creating. It's creating this reaction inside all these people. And that reaction can really go so many different ways for different people. And it either forces you to kind of go with the gender expansiveness, maybe against it, maybe with it, but also to the side. Like, it just forces people to deal with a feeling that they don't want to feel. So I think all of that's really interesting. Just how we as humans have these like just base reactions to certain things. But we just sometimes, even when we think we know everything about ourselves, we're still like not questioning where some of those parts of us are coming from.
Yeah, I have a reaction to that, Grace. Well, actually it's a question. And I know you guys have grown up exploring all of this, but and I'm admiring how you step right up and speak from the heart. Have you noticed any difference in how you communicate with other people prior to and during and, you know, from where you're at now? Has there been a qualitative difference? I know some of it's probably, you know, growing up in maturity too, but that you could attribute to the transition.
Yeah, so I'm definitely thinking about that question right now. I think that as I've gotten older more, like when I kind of recognize certain gender constructs, there was a moment where I think particularly through the transition to middle school, where I did start to talk to people differently because I was a girl and they were a boy, or that was a girl and they were a girl. Like, you start to realize that you can't just be a kid anymore. You're seen as a girl or a boy. And I remember that being like, it's kind of like you go through a slight grieving process of this like newfound experience where you like it doesn't feel good at all. And I'm sure all of you can like agree with this, that it doesn't feel good to like hear certain people like talk differently because you're a girl or a boy. And I see it just like how other people treat it. So like a guy might go to a guy and be like, what's up, bro? But if a guy goes to a woman, might be like, hi, you know, like, and they could be complete strangers. And for some women, like, I wouldn't want to be called bro. But it's just like this, It's just this difference that you grow up around that, like, you're like, I'm treated differently because of how people perceive me. And that's a hard thing to identify and then also comes to terms with. And I'm still coming to terms with it to this day. Like, as I've grown up, I've realized I have tried to stop seeing people as one or the other. Once I realized this, like, kind of categorized thing I had. And, like, recently, my mom even invited one of her friends over to tell me how it is to be a woman in the workplace, because I was going through a period of time where I was really struggling how I was going to be treated, especially because in the film industry, I did the summer camp and I just kind of felt less than. And I feel less than sometimes when I walk into these film environments because it's a very male-dominated thing. So I did start to treat other people differently. Like, you start to try to get on a guy's good side by doing certain things. Or for a girl, you interact with everyone differently. So, but as I've discovered, to the point is, like, as I discovered more of, like, these kind of constructs that are put in place, I can then identify them and then deconstruct them. And so, yeah, and I'm definitely still on that journey. I'm still, it's almost like, feels like a grieving journey to some point. And I'm learning more, but I don't know if that answers your question.
What's enough?
Grace, consider that some people, that even though you want to deconstruct them, they don't want to be deconstructed. Not speaking for myself, I'm speaking for others, yeah.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm not talking about deconstructing the individual person. I'm talking about the deconstruction of categorizing people, basically, as this or this. It's not like...
That's what I'm saying, yeah.
So you still would want to be categorized?
No. I'm saying some people... I hear you not wanting to put people into categories. I really get that. And if some people, if you don't, and I'm not speaking for myself, I'm speaking for my experience in the world, being 75 years old, I got a lot of experience around consciousness work and all that. But some people, they want you to see them as they see themselves. They don't want you to deconstruct them. So I'm not saying deconstruction is good or bad. I'm trying to help you look at maybe what's functional, what'll serve you in terms of dealing with people.
Yes, but while they might have this kind of older way of thinking, that's kind of on them, you know, to really think about why they want to be put in a category. Why do they want that treatment? Like, I don't think it should be up to me to just be like, oh, because you're like this, like, old businessman, I should be coming up with you, give you a firm handshake, respect you, act pretty, wear a dress, you know, like, that shouldn't be placed on me to do that. And that's why I think this movement kind of deconstructs that, because it forces the people who should be really thinking about it to, like, really make those changes.
I think changes can be good. And I can tell you, as a developmentalist of over 40 years, lots of my efforts to change people and help them grow, you know, have a positive spin on it, help them grow, it doesn't mean they like it.
Yeah, for sure.
So I recognize that. So I try not to push it on them.
Yeah.
To recognize that there's pros and cons to pushing it, to not pushing it. You know, just make your choices wisely and you'll learn as you grow, like we all do, and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, for sure. Like, I will never push it on them, but I will not push them onto me, basically. So yeah, that's how I think about it. I love Karen's
reaction. Yeah.
to add a little bit to that, it kind of ties into the thing from the beginning about all these labels and about this new way of looking at gender as being labels instead of categories. If for everybody who still prefers their old terms, man or man and woman, those are perfectly valid labels. So in a way, this is a theory that can collapse down to a to the more simple way of understanding we had before, but it could also be a way that has room and expansiveness for people who feel more nuanced about gender.
And think about gender people.
We can't really hear you.
Ethan, you need to be near the mic better.
Hello?
Yeah, that's better.
Because think about the violence that's done to transgender people, especially Black and brown transgender women, and, you know, about the sort of like, where does it originate from? I think a lot of it is, you know, done by men. And I feel like a lot of it is just the discomfort that that person has with seeing a transgender person, you know, and they just can't live with it. And so they try to eradicate it because they almost feel like they can't imagine themselves, you know, in that light. And so it's painful to think about.
Yeah, I'd like to speak to that a little bit. Just so I can apologize if any of my previous comments have derailed from our topic, but you know, as you speak to that point, it just brings up how proximate my safety in this country is, and how difficult it is, you know, to have any other conversation, you know, about gender for me right now. And again, that's why I think I need to apologize to the group around maybe, you know, coming off topic, because, you know, in the presence of true, you know, violence, the conversation is about the violence. And I think that's that needs to be honored here. And I appreciate you bringing that up. So, with that, I'm that's it for me.
Thank you. I would also like to add that in the context of why gender and this whole discussion is important in the path to non-duality, path to transcendence. I don't, in my experience, it might not be a spiritual thing or a non-dual thing in itself, but I believe it's one of the important pieces in working with ourselves and cleaning out our shadows. And I think a lot of the strong emotions that are tied to this subject very much points to a shadow in probably all of us. In the transgender community, it's a very big topic to talk about internalized transphobia, which is the transphobia we feel ourselves, sometimes about ourselves, sometimes about other transgender people. And if we can't get beyond it, I mean, it's totally, totally understandable that pretty much everybody have some feeling of being uncomfortable or having feeling of resistance or anger or defensiveness regarding gender. There's one thing I really would like to share that I shared in my breakout group, which is about one example of the state experience that this path had led me to. And I don't know if this translates directly to people who are not transgender, but it was a very powerful new perspective experience for me, which is that I've previously seen myself as a, you know, average guy, an average looking guy. And then whenever I was out in public among people who don't know me, I would tend to be invisible. I would only be sort of recognized or people show interest in me if I had an opinion of something or if I was perhaps qualified to do some sort of action. But I was never really seen as an embodied person. And now, as I'm transitioning, I'm kind of seeing the opposite, that I get seen a lot more. I'm a lot more visible, and you know, on a good day, that's a great thing. I love it. I love to be an embodied person and to be seen as that. But on a bad day, or if I'm in an unsafe space, it's not so great. And I can see that it was a huge privilege before, that I could turn myself invisible if I wanted to. And it's one thing I've noticed in whenever there's the debate about catcalling comes up on social media, pretty much everybody agrees that catcalling is a bad thing. But often you will see men comment something along the lines that, oh, you should take it as a compliment, or at least somebody's giving you compliments. And of course, that's a bad take in the context of catcalling. But I think it points to a pain in that is with a lot of men, which is this thing of not being seen as an embodied person. And it's something I hear from trans men, people who are transitioning from female to male, that, yeah, it's great to not be objectified, but they really also don't like this feeling of being invisible. So it's kind of like, it has given me some direct state experiences of multiple perspectives, but it's also giving me sort of a insight to the duality of one aspect of something we all deal with every day, but which tends to be invisible to us because we've just grown up with how it is.
Thank you, Louise. You know, what that arises in me is something I don't even have a very formed way of saying, but I see what's happening more and more is development and state experiences happening through embodied living. And that there's a move towards embodiment. You know, I had this kind of realization that the manifest world and the unmanifest world are co-equal and co-eternal. And I think from a gender perspective, I always had this sense that the unmanifest was superior because it was incorruptible, and the manifest was corruptible. And I always saw it was the unmanifest as male and the manifest concrete world as female. And it was always uncomfortable. And then I was almost shown this kind of co-eternality, this co-equality, and really co-oneness, not even, you know. And in that comes the opportunity to develop and state and stage through meeting life as it arises with presence, through this radical authenticity of life, we grow and develop over a lifetime. So for me, it just puts a spin on how maybe we're integrating. Maybe we're integrating interior and exterior in an embodied way, moment by moment, that's moving us forward.
Wow, beautiful, Shara. Totally resonate with that. Yes, the form, the Heart Sutra, form is emptiness. Emptiness is form. Form is not other than emptiness. Emptiness is not other than form. And this, again, as a cultural historian, as we collectively came up through the stages of first tier, I'm speaking Wilbur speak now, sorry for those of you who are, I apologize, but as we had to go through a period when our intellect was really coming online individually and collectively. We went through that concrete operational thinking, which is very binary. In, I think it is typical, as far as I know, of all of the world's wisdom traditions, as they go through that pre-modern era, we're thinking deliberately, consciously, directedly, but in very binary terms. So the spiritual, the profound spiritualities that arose in the Axial Age, you know, Buddhism, Taoism, the Western religions, Islam, Judaism, Christianity, all of the great world wisdom traditions arose where we're starting collectively to have an opening into the transcendent at a stage at which we are thinking in very binary terms. It seems to be one of the deep structures of that phase, that stage, where we can only understand in terms of binaries. And so all of the world's wisdom traditions, in my understanding, we tended to see the transcendent as superior and the embodied as inferior. This is common through all of the traditional levels, the blue amber levels in all of the world's wisdom traditions. And we're collectively outgrowing that now. And one of the great glories, as I see, that you expressed so beautifully just now, Shara, is as we are collectively moving, beginning to move into the integral where we're integrating it all. And I feel this great call, I'm hearing it arise spontaneously all over, for an embodied spirituality that opens into the trans-dual, the non-dual, the transcendent, while we're embodied. And that's the being here now in this moment. Some of the great teachers of our present day, I think Shinzen Young is one of my favorites. Eckhart Tolle is speaking from that place. There's so many wonderful teachers now who are bringing us forward, keeping the glories of the transcendence that we have, that we collectively opened into in a prior arising stage. And we're now transcending and including that and bringing back the embodied, that the form and the emptiness are co-equal, a beautiful binary, and that they are collectively, that there is a transcendent even beyond that. It's just so thrilling to be part of a group that's exploring these beauties together. Thank you. I just want to thank you so much, you and Evan and Grace. Thank you so much. I said it in the chat, but your courage and your authenticity, evolution isn't going to stop. You younger generation, us old folks who are around for the 60s and 70s, that was the new wave then. You are the wave that's coming on shore now, and I am watching it with joy. Thank you so much for your presentation.
I'd like to hear from Grace and Evan just briefly, or however long they want to talk, what this experience was like for you with us. Yeah.
I definitely enjoyed it. I enjoyed seeing the different viewpoints and answering some questions and just like talking to everyone. And yeah, I enjoyed it.
Sorry, I did not mean to put that no reaction. I was just trying to get rid of that heart. And I was like, I don't know. I found this like a super informative, interesting meeting. It was definitely a very emotionally intense meeting, I feel like, for me. Like, I feel I'm a little bit like, oh, I could go to bed right now. But it was a productive conversation, which I always love. And I always love hearing people's different perspectives on things. And I think it helps, me grow as a person when I hear other people's thoughts, and I feel like I'm a better communicator when I do that. So I'm thankful that I was able to hear from everyone and that I was allowed to even be here today. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Grace. Thank you, Ivan.
I want to give a huge thank you too to everyone. I told Eloy in the chat, you know, I was very vulnerable coming here today. I actually didn't tell many of my friends about this event because I was so unsure how it would unfold. And I am just so grateful for the sincerity of communal exploration. So thank you, everybody.
Yeah, thank you all for sticking around for the extra hour too. It made it even richer and more beautiful. I just want to say a quick thing on the back to the embodiment. I think you brought that up at the beginning when you said something about how much aliveness you saw in your kids as they made this journey. it was like visible or palpable.
Yeah, Shara, I want to commend your courage and for bringing your children on, and acknowledge you for what a great couple of kids you've raised and help them navigate what they're navigating, not only in consciousness, but the whole gender issue, even for them just being two human beings in the world, trying to function, all that. So good job. Kudos.
Thank you. And I just want to underscore it's a reciprocal plus, you know, yes. They are raising me and they are raising my consciousness and they are helping me see what I didn't even know to look for. I really, really, the shadow work and that they're exposing for me what I didn't know I didn't even know. So I'm very grateful to be in this sacred relationship with Ivan and Grace.
Awesome.
Yeah, and thank everybody for coming. And it's about time to close out now. I'm at my edge, so thank you everybody. And we'll see you next month. And there'll be a recording. It might be a couple more. It might be more than 2 days. But we'll get it out as soon as we can and let you know.
Oh, good.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Unless Shara doesn't want us to put out a recording.
Wonderful, wonderful.
thank you, everyone.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Good work.
Good night. Good work. Lovely to meet you, Louise. Thank you.
Should I leave right now?
The room's going to close.
For further information, including upcoming events, resources, links to our Facebook and Meetup pages, and our fabulous donate button, please visit our website at sandiegointegral.org. Donations are greatly appreciated and help us to continue to provide information and connection within the Integral community.